Hi, my name is Stephanie, and today I want to talk to you about autism and eye contact. But real quick before that, I just wanted to, again, shout out this shirt. I feel like I did this last video, but I don't remember. Also, I have a Facebook page now. I used to not. I tried it for like a millisecond, and now I have it. And I've been posting a lot of my older videos on there, as well as my new videos as they come out. So if you want to follow me on Facebook, you can go ahead and do that. The link is in the description. So eye contact is typically something that is a major point of consideration for professionals when they are looking at possible autism. It's like one of the big things that they put on the little mini checklists of whether your child could possibly be autistic. Do they struggle with eye contact? See, the problem here is that it's so stereotypically known that autistics tend to have issues with eye contact that a lot of professionals will dismiss children, teens, and adults who are capable of maintaining some form of eye contact because they believe that all autistics cannot keep eye contact when that's simply not true. However, for most autistics, they do report that eye contact is difficult. It might not come as naturally. A lot of times, autistics are trained to maintain eye contact anywhere on the spectrum. And while this can seem beneficial, because eye contact is considered a very important nonverbal communication skill and a social skill for interacting with others, a lot of autistics say that this can be harmful or even borderline abusive. Now, while I don't know that I would take it to that extent, I do want to explain to you why some autistics have the kind of difficulty that they have with eye contact through both self-report and a scientific reason why this might be happening. Many autistics report that eye contact can literally be physically painful for them. Others feel overwhelmed, especially those who are very sensitive to others. It does turn out that a lot of autistic people are highly sensitive and not able to regulate that kind of thing. So looking someone in the eye, which is for many reasons traditionally known as the window to the soul, you're getting a lot of that person. And if you're highly sensitive to that, that can be really difficult and really overwhelming. So there's a lot of self-report on that. A lot of autistics who aren't traditionally good at eye contact can kind of swing to the opposite in their attempts to do this right, the social way. And instead of just like doing the normal amount, whatever that is, of eye contact, we get this. Hi, my name is Stephanie. And see, with this difficulty, whether it is physically painful or just awkward and unnatural for the autistic, this can often overtake the conversation on the autistic side. Have you ever thought so much about what you're gonna say to somebody that you have no idea what they just said? So sometimes they'll do those things where like, oh, go greet your neighbor, blah, blah, blah. And you're just thinking, my name is Stephanie, my name is Stephanie, my name is Stephanie. And they say your name and you're just ready. My name is Stephanie. And you have no idea what they said their name was. You just pretended you heard them and you were just thinking over and over, my name is Stephanie. Well, that kind of phenomenon happens a lot with autistic individuals with eye contact. Make eye contact, make eye contact, make eye contact, make eye contact, make eye contact. And the rest of the information is gone. I don't know your name. I don't know what we're talking about. I don't even really know what I'm looking at other than I'm staring into your eyes because this is social skills. And it's definitely one of those unpleasant kind of things. Now, on a personal note, I think that in general I do pretty good with eye contact, but I have had a history of trouble with eye contact. I do remember specifically an interaction with my husband before we were even dating where he noticed my lack of eye contact and tried to encourage eye contact there, which was super awkward because I also liked him, so like looking him in the eye while liking him was also really difficult. So something I have noticed, and maybe this is normal to everybody, I have no idea. When I'm trying to explain things or like, I guess, access memory, I do look away, but here where I look back at you a lot of the times, I'm not always going to do that in an actual eye contact person-to-person situation. So if I'm listening to you, I was always taught as a child, you always look at the person speaking. that's what you're supposed to do. That's the good thing to do. And I always wanted to please people. I always wanted to be the good kid, follow the rules, that kind of thing. And so I always watched my teachers. I don't know that I looked them in their eye, but I mean, they're far enough away, so it's not awkward, you know. I experienced issues with recognizing faces, which I think can be partially attributed to not always looking people in the face. A lot of my memories as a child, I don't always remember faces. I remember things and things being said to me. So it's very possible that I didn't make a lot of eye contact, and that might have contributed to a little bit of very minor face blindness. That's something I'll probably go into in a different video. But when I am talking out of like a lot of emotion or trying to access information that's just not really easy for me to just get out, I tend to look away. A lot of times it's like over here and I will focus on an object, and it's a lot easier to talk. What's great about YouTube is that you are the object. This lens in front of me is the object. So it's not so hard all the time to make eye contact with the camera lens. But in person, a lot of times I can look at you, especially as long as like I'm not ashamed, I guess, or scared of what you're going to say to me. But if I'm talking, it's not extremely likely that I'll maintain eye contact. And I don't know if that's a normal thing or not. I know that I've definitely tried to do the eye contact thing, but it's so hard because when you're not used to making excessive amounts of eye contact, you don't have a good idea of how long other people make eye contact. Because the reality is, most people really don't do this the whole time, even though that's kind of what they want from autistic individuals when they're teaching them eye contact, which is really weird. So now I've heard from other autistics that they didn't know that this was abnormal, and their way of making eye contact, well, not actually making eye contact, was to look at people's lips when they talked, or look at their eyebrows, look at something that's not actually their eye, that's in their face region, so that they felt that they were being made eye contact with them, but they really weren't quite doing that. These are things that as autistic individuals we find pretty normal, but others are surprised to find out that we're not always looking right in your eye. But I suspect that might be because a lot of people overemphasize eye contact, but that's a personal thing. Let me get back on track here. So while maybe I can't connect to this on the level that some others can when it comes to eye contact, this has been something I've heard a lot about. Again, it's one of the main things that professionals are going to be looking for to see if the person is autistic or not. And I've also heard a lot of self-reporting about how it's just too much to like connect with people with direct eye contact. And while I've heard these things, I haven't really heard a scientific reason for why this might be. So in that vein, one day I was just thinking about one of the stims that I've seen children do before. It's just that I saw children doing it. It's not that adults can do it, it's just I haven't seen adults do it personally or noticed it. But what they would do is they would move their face, and I think what they're doing is moving things into their peripheral vision, because they're like doing this thing and they're smiling, it's so cute. And they're like moving, and they're like, and they'll kind of look at you through their peripheral, or they'll look at whatever they're wanting to look at through their peripheral vision. And I thought that was really interesting, the kind of sensations that we kind of mess with that are interesting to us, that give us maybe a different sensation than the typical person. And then I was thinking about how a lot of autistics actually report having excellent peripheral vision. Can't relate, as I am a glasses wearer and my peripheral vision becomes significantly sketchy once I pass like this part of my lens. But some people really do, and report that that's why they're paying attention to you, but might not seem like they're looking at what you want them to look at, because they can see it through their peripheral vision, but they're not going to turn their whole like body to look at that. So that was just something I was thinking was kind of interesting. And then I came across this article that talks about the sensation of feeling like people are staring at you. And this has been a thing, obviously, people have been kind of interested in. Everybody feels at some point that they're being watched or looked at or whatever. And they were looking into why that might be. But this particular article gave me information that, to me, helps completely explain why autistic people might have trouble with eye contact. So this article describes a 2013 study that they did with a man who is cortically blind, and what they did was they presented images, and some images have what appears to be a person staring at him, and some images have what appears to be a person looking past him. Now again, he is cortically blind. What that means is that he can't see in the traditional sense, because I believe something with the occipital lobe is messed up, so he's not going to actually see an image. But his eyes are still giving his brain information. So they did this specifically with cortically blind because of that information. They wanted to see if he's able to tell that someone is looking at him without actually seeing them looking at him, if that makes sense. Now, he couldn't explain it, but they were also, of course, looking at his brain and what's happening in his brain while this is happening. And when he was presented with the images of people looking at him, there was a spike in activity in his amygdala. So there's information other than just plain old visual information coming into our eyes. Our eyes are telling us more than just the picture. So this makes a lot of sense, because if you didn't know, the autistic brain is quite unique, and there are so many unique sensitivities, so many different things that happen in the autistic brain that might not happen in your typically developing brain. And even from autistic to autistic, you're going to have different types of sensitivities, different types of things that are, I don't know, feel good or feel bad or overwhelm or don't overwhelm that particular individual, which would explain why some people don't have that much of an issue with eye contact compared to others who literally feel pain looking someone in the eye. Now, the amygdala, which is what is having that activity spike when someone is looking you in the eye, presumably from this study, is something that responds to threat and arousal. It's actually connected to a lot of different parts of your brain, but has a very primary role in fear. It helps you to recognize the expressions of other people, and I believe recognize your own feelings. But from my understanding, although the amygdala can assist in those things, it is very primarily for fear, the perception of fear in others and in yourself. Now, to me, this is actually pretty groundbreaking information just to put together. Maybe people have already talked about this, maybe everyone knows this, but I certainly hadn't heard of it. And it sure makes sense that someone who already has a different way of interpreting information received from the world inside of their brain to have an issue with their amygdala and how that works with understanding the expressed emotion on others. A lot of autistic people have alexithymia, I'm probably saying that wrong, which is difficulty, I believe, in being able to identify and maybe know what they're feeling, if that makes sense, or when they're feeling something, not always being able to give a name to it, those sorts of things. In this case, think about it, if someone processes their perceptions of the world differently, or maybe just like pretend you turned up the volume of the world, while someone normally looking someone in the eyes has a spike in the amygdala activity, which is dealing with fear primarily, imagine that level going up more. It becomes literally scary for that person to look someone in the eye. And it's not because they're being rude. It's not because they're trying to act like they don't care about somebody. They're not being lazy. They're not being, I don't know, whatever words people come up with for someone who doesn't make eye contact, being shifty or whatever. It is literally fearful, and some people might be translating that inside as painful to look someone in the eye, because there's actual information and sensations happening when you make eye contact with someone. So I thought that was interesting, because a lot of times therapies will try to make sure that an autistic individual will make eye contact, because it's an important part of social communication. However, I think we should be careful in pushing that, because when you're doing a social situation already, this is uncomfortable anyway. Trying to remember how to act, how to stand, what to say, etc. is very difficult. So trying to add on, look at this complete stranger, this new information I'm going to be getting from this complete stranger, making eye contact with a new sensation of a stranger, that's scary. That is out of their control, scary, maybe even painful. And we just stand here, oh, well, you should just remember, look, where are their eyes? Look, 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 look. Like, that's, I think it's just a misunderstanding of the autistic experience. So I highly recommend that if you are a parent or someone who works with autistic individuals, take into consideration the actual reality behind what's happening inside the autistic individual when going through things like this. Some people would highly benefit from not being forced to make eye contact. And in the case that it's so immensely important, some people say, like, it's so important for their culture, like, it's insanely important, and people just aren't going to understand. At least try to meet some middle ground, because maybe explaining, hey, look at their nose instead. Hey, look at their eyebrow instead. I know it's really hard to make the eye contact. Can you maybe look here, look there, look there, somewhere near the person's eye, just to at least alleviate that. I know looking at faces is already intimidating for some people, but maybe if you can kind of meet halfway in the cases where it's that important to people that their child makes some sort of eye contact, because a lot of people will kind of learn to trick the system by doing that, but a lot of these children and others are being taught you have to look directly in someone's eye, when again, we're finding scientifically there's reasons why this is so difficult for people who have sensory processing disorder and autism and such. So just keep that in mind. Please be respectful of individuals, whether they make eye contact or not. It's not always because they don't respect you, because a lot of people try to put that meaning on them. For someone who doesn't do social cues very well, it's really absurd for us to expect them to be showing that level of social meaning. So when we say, you know, oh, that person's not looking me in the eye, and clearly they don't seem to understand social cues in general, they're not trying to send you a social cue message of I don't respect you, because they clearly aren't really familiar with the social cues in general, if that makes sense. Anyway, so I was just hoping that we could have a little bit of a better understanding of why autism and eye contact might be a thing. Maybe you have more information on this, but this was just something that, you know, when your brain connects two concepts together and you're like, oh, that makes sense. That's what happened to me, and I wanted to share it with you guys. So again, please be respectful of people. If they don't make eye contact, it's probably for a good reason. It's not because they're being jerks. And please, caretakers, parents, teachers, therapists, whatever, please keep in mind that many people on the spectrum do experience an overload of this particular sensation. Anyway, thank you so much for watching this video. I know it's probably a long one. I got rambly, again, went off script. I did weird stuff, as in, like, pretty much nothing with my hair today. My apologies. This video is gonna have to, like, really go quickly through the process, because otherwise you won't have a video and that won't be very cool. So anyway, if you enjoyed it, go ahead and give it a thumbs up. Let me know your thoughts about all of this in the comments below, if you've ever heard of this sensation, why this might be a thing, if you heard any other information that would be interesting for us to know about. Also, I do upload to this channel every Thursday at 4 p.m. Central Standard Time to the best of my ability. So if you're interested in autism-related content from me, go ahead and hit that subscribe button. I hope that you're having a wonderful week, and see me in my next video. Bye!